Just to add to that, the lenders worry because I think both of them have seen this day in, day out. The RBI in 2016, June, I think, came out with a guideline called the S4A. It's the Scheme for Sustainable Structuring. As per that guideline, if 50%, half the debt that you have taken is viable, then you fall within the ambit of that scheme. We have seen at least 8 companies, personally I have seen, who can't meet that criteria. So that is the level of NPA or bad debt situation that we are talking about in the thermal or the real estate or the steel space. So, you know, as he was saying, it is extremely crucial that the debt financing is tied up appropriately and the assumptions are taken correctly so that we don't end up in this situation in this sector as well, because this is, at least in my understanding, only the booming sector vis-a-vis debt funding. E-commerce, of course, has a lot of equity coming in as well. I think the government has come out with the basic problem in India is the lack of scare of enforcement. If you go to you know, the developed countries, the enforcement has been strong. There is Chapter 11 in the US, and you saw one of the biggest giants, Sun Edison, fall. But enforcement was strong. In India, you have not had that for a while. And I think the government is treading on that path by bringing out changes in the Arbitration Act and the newly enacted Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code to ensure that the people who are doing business do it seriously and are fully aware of the consequences of that business if the business fails. And there shouldn't be a way out based on lack of enforcement for them now.
See, yeah, so that's the whole thing. We keep getting asked, why are we financing based after taking some support from the corporate balance sheet? And the answer lies there only. The model has been such, it has been that it has not been proven, and that is why banks have to resort a little bit to the balance sheet of the corporates. Like, giving you an example of some of the recent lower bids, if they come to us for lending and we have been evaluating a lot of them, if you ask us what are the top two criteria, the number one would be who is the borrower, and number two is what is the project and what is the bid. So from that perspective, that is how that is the reason why India has been slow in financing, at least the Indian private banks have been slow in financing projects on non-recourse basis. But there is your answer. And that is why banks are continuously stressing on a bit of support from the corporate balance sheet and who is the borrower. It is very important. Does the borrower have a track record? That is the whole thought process behind it.
Clearly, you know, if I can try to take the answer to the question, right? Clearly, investors who bid 2.44 or such aggressive bids do believe that given their cost of equity and given the availability of debt, it still is a viable project that will return money back. What are the assumptions that have gone into it? Obviously, pretty aggressive assumptions. I think two key assumptions that that developers have made, which may or may not hold true. One is a continuous fall in module prices, pretty much on track with what we've seen in the last few years. I know we have seen a very aggressive fall in prices. Will it continue again into the future? Anybody's guess. It's a question of taking a future view, right? If you have an 18-month time to completion, if you believe that your modules are coming in 12 months later, if you believe that in those 12 months, FX is not, rupee is not going to depreciate further. Yeah, so it's as much a view in terms of where you want to assume you're going to actually incur the module cost and the dollar rupee cost. That's just one of the assumptions that have gone into it. And therefore, what would be a level at which you're willing to accept to actually win the bid. In fact, a very related question, and Prateek, this is probably for you. Obviously, there is a lot of premium that is being attached to building a large-scale platform. We have seen many platforms change hands. at extremely attractive valuations.
Yeah.
I think Wellspun Tata Power is one example. The reported Hindustan Power Macquarie sale is another example.
Yeah.
Do you think that such, you know, the desire to build a platform and to kind of get a premium just because you have an existing large platform is one of the drivers of lower tariffs?
Absolutely. So I think you have sort of hit the nail on its head. The reason, and the IRR, people always talk about IRRs declining on the project level. So bids were made at 16% IRRs, and I can't even say what the number is currently. But you have to start looking at it as a portfolio level, and we deal with a lot of these investors who have been investing and a lot of investors who are planning to invest in India also. And the driver is, once you start building a portfolio, once you start moving from the 20 megawatt towards 100 and 150, then there are a lot of financial engineering and optimization of capital structure that you can do to take those IRRs from 12 to 14% level to a respectable level that an infrastructure equity investor would like. And that is the reason why IRRs have been lower at the project level, with the optimism that they will grow as you move to a platform level. And that is why you see everybody wanting to look at building a platform, and high sort of valuation deals happening at platform level rather than having it happening at the project level.
And Saurabh, do you think that the optimism that, you know, financial engineering will provide larger returns in the future, do you think that's a valid optimism?
No, I think to an extent it is valid optimism, because you see, as we as a country grow and hopefully we'll get re-rated globally in terms of our risk profile, and let's say if we see a couple of rating notch upgrades, we might see the cost of capital going down in the country. Right? Today, domestic investor expectations are IRRs in mid-teens, probably. Why not? Maybe a 10%. Or globally, the investors, there is a large investor class in terms of pension funds or yieldcos who are happy to have a high single-digit yield also. And as long as these projects have, let's say, maybe a double-digit IRR, you know, even if it's early teens, there is an upside for it, because these are long tenure projects. So there is an upside for sure. But of course, it has to be backed, and it has to be seen as to, will you see the light of on that day, because you don't want it to be falling too soon, right? The rates are not going to fall probably in next 6 months, 12 months, or even 36 months time. It may take time, but as you said, the platforms will definitely get valued at probably premium, subject to, of course, them being able to build that scale and, you know, sustain for that period.
Any further questions on the viability of the of these aggressive bids?
Is there a minimum equity required?
So there is no thumb rule, of course, and with these kind of bids, you would definitely look at cash flows and SCRs rather than a debt equity, because there's no more.
From lender's point of view, what is the minimum?
No, so that's what I said. There's no more, those conventional benchmarks hold no more, because at this kind of cash flows, we'll have to see what kind of debt the project can support. So debt sizing will have to be done looking at project specific cash flows rather than a thumb rule of, let's say, a 75-25 or a 80-20 or God knows what.
Nothing is like.
So there's no set benchmark for project.
Can be even less, like 10% or so.
Subject to cash flow supporting, of course, lenders will take it up.
Yeah, I mean, the current market has seen the debt equity somewhere in the range of 70-30 to 80-20. It hasn't varied too much beyond that for a straitjacket IPP project and the construction phase.
What is the rate of interest in such
projects? They can also answer, but the projects I have seen has during construction finance has usually been, depending on the credit rating of the company, somewhere between 9.5 to 12.
And interestingly, if you look at, for example, there are lines of credit today that are available, for example, for rooftop projects. Right, there's the celebrated World Bank line that's being given through the SBI. There's an ADB line that's coming through PNB. There's a KfW line which is being put out through IREDA. If you look at some of the rates on those, they're much below the lower end of the range that Karan mentioned. And you're essentially talking here of an aggregation of rooftop projects, which obviously means a much better risk because there is a portfolio effect out there. But at the same time, a much more difficult kind of project to monitor because there are so many different projects across so many different locations. But the fact is rates are actually going down, lower down, even lower than the 9 level that I've heard for rooftop projects because of the availability of cheap credit. Okay. So, as a banker, I'd say that, right? Clearly, if I have a large size project, it's economies of scale. My costs are lower, therefore I'm able to go do a much lower rate. On the other hand, if it's a single project, a single rooftop project is obviously going to be a much higher rate because it's a huge cost for me to be able to deliver the loan. Correct. But here I'm just looking at the financing rates as such.
We're talking about the banking part. How are the banks?
Anybody wants to take that?
Yeah, so that is why if you look at the recent investments by pension funds, they have been in large platforms where they see some visibility of exit, but the nature of these investments has not been pure equity. The nature of these investments has been a little mezzanine kind of structure where they're looking at an assured return. And when you do that kind of a structure, you can look at exit not just by monetization by the platform through sale or IPO or whatever, but also from refinancing. So that sort of mitigates that risk a little bit. And that is why if you see most of the recent equity investments, and we have also done a few of them, we have syndicated a few of them as investment bankers in some of the larger platforms. And these have been mezzanine kind of investments. That is how they are sort of looking at the risk.
So hedging clearly remains a big challenge in India. It's one, the availability of hedging limits; two, the availability of a liquid market; three, the cost of hedging. Right, all put together basically mean the hedging may not. I mean, you add the cost of hedging, you're going to make yourself uncompetitive in terms of foreign capital. What has been the approach of foreign investors? To the extent that they're long-term investors, and long-term can mean anywhere between say 5 years and beyond. There's been a general view that it's better to remain unhedged. Because if anybody ever looked at the graph of a rupee, you'll see a lot of spikes, you'll see a lot of depreciation. But if you look at the weighted average depreciation of the rupee over a 15, 20 year period, it's been less than 3% per annum. It's been less than the cost of hedging. So if you hedged systematically, and instead on the other hand, you kept it open all the while, you're probably better off having kept it open at all. But on an average, the risk clearly is that sharp depreciation moves like you saw in 2013 could just wipe out the project, especially if you had a repayment or a redemption during that unfortunate phase. It's like the joke about, it's like the story about the river that was 3 feet deep on an average and the army tried to cross it. They all drowned because 3 feet deep on average doesn't mean much. It is the spikes that really end up drowning the army. Clearly, most investors that we talk to don't look at hedging. They may look at opportunistic hedging to take certain advantages. For example, now the rupee is appreciated, they may look at locking in some hedges, especially if they have some redemption coming up. But on a systematic long-term basis, hedging is not the way forward. And again, if you go back to some of the assumptions made, especially by many international, not just international developers, but even local developers, clearly assumptions have been very aggressive on the expected behavior of dollar rupee. Fortunately, it has come true for many of them because some of the bids were actually done at 67, 68, and now it's at 64, 65. But the assumption has been that at least rupee will be stable, if not appreciate, over an extended period of time. How good the assumption is, only time will tell.
The NCA issues weighing the banking sector, the ECB framework challenges. So just want to get into how do you see the market playing out over the next 5 years?
Yeah, so that is a market that will eventually definitely have to pick up. So I would like to ask you, sir. I mean, are you from the borrower community, or are you from the financial? Okay, fine. So as you know, banks have a lending book as well as they have a syndication book. And so on the bond side, there are two kinds of bonds. There are the project level bonds and there are the portfolio level bonds. And on the project level bond side, we have seen two kinds of bonds. The fundamental mental challenge in the bond, and I see why you're asking the question also, is the rating of the offtaker. And bonds are linked to the rating of the entire project, which is linked to the rating of the offtaker, and that is the reason why bonds have not been able to pick up. But on the project side, there have been instances where there have been credit enhanced bonds for certain projects, wherein a credit enhancer can come in. Probably it sort of hits a bit on the competitiveness on the pricing, but there is a way out there. On the project level, that is definitely a structure. On the corporate level, now earlier it was only the large financial institutions like banks who were raising green bonds. Now I have seen some of the two large IPPs in India also who have raised green bonds at the portfolio level, and the pricing of that has been competitive with the term loans or even lower. So yeah, there is a clear opportunity on the project level in refinancing side. And then there is opportunity at the portfolio level as well.
Yeah. So as Prateek rightly said, project level bonds probably are still some way to go. But at portfolio level, we've seen not just bonds, but let's say this new phenomenon of InvITs that we've seen recently, where at portfolio level, now as long as the risk is understood and measured, and the portfolio achieves reasonable level of rating, and we've seen both last InvITs at AAA rated, but I'm sure there'll be market for even a AA sort of paper for renewable assets going forward. But the avenues for portfolio level bonds are definitely opening up, and we also have an AMC, say, and we've seen a lot of influent debt funds in last couple of years, and invest in AIF, which are alternative investment funds, which will be new avenues for these project bonds, not project bonds, I would say portfolio level bonds or debt instruments, which will move from bank books to capital markets.
I mean, just to add on that, bond markets don't like construction risk. So normally bond markets is normally the banks that really take on the construction risk. Bond markets are most effective when you have a post-construction phase. I think one interesting thing that we've seen, as Saurabh mentioned, clearly is holdco level bonds, where you're seeing on a portfolio basis. We have seen at least two players. We're expecting many more. And you know, that's quite related not just to renewables. It's just the fact that today there's a huge appetite in the globe, across the world, for high-yield Asian credits and high-yield Indian credits. Also, with these two celebrated issuances that have gone into the market, there's an understanding of what the sector entails. There's an understanding of what exactly a DISCOM risk or a DISCOM rating really means in terms of cash flows. Understanding in terms of structure, because the structures are very complex, right? These are refinancing transactions, financing being done at the holdco level, being dropped into the actual operating SPVs, has issues around RBI, around local laws, local regulations, ECB regulations, etc. And solutions have been found for that. So clearly, this is a very interesting opportunity. And if we look at it, it's quite close to what the yieldco model really was. This is, in some ways, a debt yieldco rather than an equity yieldco. So it's a defined return and a defined time frame. Unlike an equity yieldco, which has an infinite time frame and potentially higher returns into the future. Maybe on that point, right? We have seen yieldcos obviously took a real beating with SunEdison. I think, unfortunately, SunEdison was kind of the bellwether for yieldcos. SunEdison going down and part of legal cases around it, blaming the yieldcos for it, or the yieldcos blaming SunEdison for it, obviously meant that yieldcos have kind of got a credibility hit. But obviously in India, we have kind of gone in very cautiously into it. InvITs have done well. We have had two issuances coming out in the market. How does this panel see the potential for renewable InvITs in India?
Personally, I don't see InvITs in the renewable space doing too well, primarily because of the lack of variation in return or pricing because of the underlying PPA prices. The only variation that can come across is through the electricity supply. But on fixed price contracts with no escalation, which is most of the contracts except for certain contracts which are levelized, I don't see too much of an investor appetite personally. I, as an investor, would be cautious investing in a renewable energy InvIT.
I think I would disagree there because, as you rightly said, you know, yield goes typically look at a stable return. Or InvITs probably are the last two InvIT issuances that we've seen. They are also, in a way, projecting stable return to the investors. And that's where the appetite, as you said, has been on higher yielding papers in Asia and India. Now, how soon will renewables probably have an InvIT issuances would depend upon you know, how the entire industry stabilizes. Because before that, there has to be clear visibility of you know, sanity in the market, probably with these new benchmarks and investors and all classes of investors, including debt and equity and you know, I know fixed income investors, everybody doubting the sustainability of these numbers. Till the time the numbers hit a sustainable level and remain there for a period, I see there will be you know, people will be skeptical about the future of renewable if this wild fluctuation keeps happening on, you know, probably 30% tariff cut in 6 months time. I don't think till the time that remains, I see that's not happening.
See, with InvITs now, I think the government has sort of addressed some of the challenges which were there in the traditional American yieldco model by eliminating the factor of growth and making it proper annuity returns. However, whether it will be successful or not, we'll have to be seen after the first renewable InvIT comes in. But the aspect of sponsor participation in InvIT is still there, right? So it is ultimately, even if you have a third party valuer who is doing the valuation for the InvIT, ultimately who is supplying the assumptions to that valuer? It is still going to be the large participant, which is the sponsor to the InvIT, who is also a developer. So the valuation of the InvIT still has to be done properly so that we don't repeat the mistakes of yieldcos in America. And then I think it should look sustainable and we should have some exits from InvITs as well. It is a well thought of model. The thought has been right. It just had to be executed and implemented properly.
Sure.
So maybe I can just take that. Clearly, getting financing for a smaller size project is often a challenge because rooftop projects, while they are very socially acceptable, while they're, you know, a very interesting way of doing of having distributed generating, do represent the undue concentration of risk for a lender. Because the off-taker is also the owner of the rooftop. What happens if something goes wrong? You necessarily will not get paid. Clearly, what's the way forward has been large players who have developed very strong, robust projects with very good PPAs. And maybe Karan can draw some light on what quality, what needs to go into those PPAs. But clearly, those kind of projects on an aggregated basis with very reputed counterparties, normally commercial and industrial, are good for refinancing. Because post-construction, they represent a very good portfolio of diverse cash flows coming from different off-takers. And that is essentially what today a World Bank or an ADB or a KfW is trying to promote in India. They are willing to stand behind, provide at least cheap capital to Indian lenders, as long as Indian lenders are comfortable with the risk of it. And which is the example that I gave you. The World Bank SBI loan is available today to rooftop lenders at a very, very attractive rate. But these are available not for a single project, but for a large aggregation of projects that a developer is willing to put together.
But not to individual institute or customer. You have to be a big developer.
Not necessarily. So the way it really works is if you are a well-reputed...
schools, hospitals, some schools, private schools, they want to
find... If you are a reputed off-taker who has a good reputation and a credit history and ability to pay, then they are developers willing to put projects onto your rooftop because they know later they can get a refinance much cheaper going forward. And that's happening more today in the commercial and industrial space, happening less in the institutional space, but it's a matter of time before it moves there. Residential will be still some distance away because residential on a standalone basis represents an undue risk. The solution that we've seen in countries like Germany, which has made a big success of this, has been to bundle residential rooftop along with mortgages. Included within the cost of housing, people don't default on mortgages. That is the first loan that they always pay. So to the extent that you can do it correctly within and bundle it within mortgages, that works very well. Let me change tack now, just looking at potential M&A transactions in the renewable space. Obviously, as we spoke, a lot of developers looking at putting together platforms. The reason is, even if the platform cash flows seem to be providing very fine returns on equity, the platform by itself seems to attract a very interesting valuation, a very good valuation. Do you think this is sustainable? And where do you think the interest is going to come from?
Yeah, so that's right. And the interest largely is going to come, it could come from mainly two ways. One is the foreign strategic players. And foreign strategic, and I would include some of the large Indian corporates as well there, as if you would have seen the Tata Power Wealthspan transaction. The second interest is going to come from the funds. And these funds would include all the funds who are looking at aggregating renewable assets and looking at infrastructure level equity returns. So that renewable in India has moved from a traditional private equity model to an infrastructure equity model. And if you are building projects on a portfolio level, it can still generate the infrastructure equity returns. And that is where we're largely going to see the investor interest from. Unfortunately, it's not going to be the pension funds or the sovereign wealth funds who would like to take operating risk also by acquiring projects. It is going to be the infrastructure focused funds and the corporates. Those corporates we have already seen. We have seen Tata Power buying Wealthspan portfolio. We were involved in the transaction. There was recently Hinduja Group coming in, and they, instead of taking development risk, they bought the operation. They bought an operational asset from us, and soon are going to buy another. So these are the avenues. These are the main buyers who are going to come in for M&A of these kind of portfolio level assets.
Okay.